standard for roads in British Columbia is not living up to the forecast that BC Hydro has been making. Every couple of years, they do a comprehensive forecast. They add up all the houses, and the new people come to the province, and the industry, and the commercial, and they produce a trajectory off of the future. And by complete accident, this always turns out to be 2% a year for the forecast was 2% in 1995. It was 2% in 2005. 2% in 2010, 2012, 2013, 2016. The reality has been short of that. It has been flat since 2005. The demand now is just about what it was then. A little wobble around 2008, but it went down, came back out, and it's been flat. Nor do we expect it to grow very much. The industrial demand for electricity has been falling. In fact, it's down about 60% in the last decade, largely because the forestry industry has had hard times. We've cut all the trees, no more logging to do, no more paper to be made, substantial disinvestment in favor of Georgia and Louisiana. So that's where we're going. The commercial demand has been flat, in part because there are off-grid alternatives, but really because conservation is sparse and makes sense at prices in the run. For consumers, efficiencies are matching population growth. People are paying attention to when they buy new refrigerators or when they buy LED lights instead of incandescent bulbs and so on. So that's a walk. Population is growing. Efficiency is also growing slowly. The justification behind the forecast that was made in 2013 for the panel was that ordinary organic growth in British Columbia from residential, commercial, and industrial uses would add up to this roughly 2% a year. Nothing special was thrown into that equation. A relatively small kind of placeholder number was entered for the demand from the LNG industry, which was going to be promised momentarily. But other than that, nothing special was thrown. A figure for electric cars, for example, it was just too small. Likewise, the assumption on the demand side was that people would only be rational if they were bribed to do so. That is, there had to be a positive expenditure by BC Hydro, say, over your bill and the other right kind of lines or something like that, in order to see any efficiency changes. That's turned out not to be true. People do the smart things. Elasticity is a big thing in forecasting. If something is more expensive, you tend to buy less of it. You can substitute something, you might conserve it, but you're going to buy less of it. There's very few exceptions, and Tiffany sells them often. Price of electricity in British Columbia was essentially flat from 1970 through to about 2013 or 14. In real terms, it was so low that none of us had to pay attention to it. It just wasn't part of the calculus. Since 2014 in particular, prices have started to rise in real terms rapidly, and they're forecast to do so essentially forever. Through the time when the bill for Site C hits the rates, and then it will take off again. So we expect that to have an effect on demand. As I say, prices are rising about three times the rate of inflation in normal terms. And because of some accounting shenanigans in that's entirely aside from this cross-elasticity issue, which has to do with most other goods, other sources of energy. So for all those reasons, I conclude that we're not going to need a whole lot more electric energy for some time to come, decades, given that we are already producing much more than we can sell. Hydro produces about 70 terawatt hours a year, sells about 50. They need some reserve in hand for disasters, transmission line breaks, and so on and so forth. They need, of course, some peaking power, which is separate from this energy figure. But no matter how you slice it, they've got more than they need now. And there are at least five alternatives should we turn out to need new supply in the short term, say the next 10, 20 years. We are entitled to the use of half of the incremental power that was generated on the Columbia River on the U.S. side by the building of the storage dams in Canada. That averages about 1,300 megawatts a year, rather more than say Cedar Road. A little bit less in energy terms, 4,000 to 5,000, but still very much the same kind of resource. We currently accept that as order, and it goes for about 2 feet in Canada, and we sell it back to the state at the spot market price. The last measured number was $22.46 US a megawatt hour. Put that, I might say, against the cost of hydro, of subsea, which is going to be close enough to maybe $105 a megawatt hour. In other words, we could have all of Site C, if we need it, at a quarter of the price. BC Hydro also estimated, very loosey-goosey back at the end of the week, that there was about 700 megawatts of geothermal power available in British Columbia at competitive prices, but prices competitive with Site C is what they meant. They also put together a suite of geothermal, of hydro, small hydro, wind and solar installations that would add up to the same amount of Site C and said that that could be more than the same price as Site C. But didn't want to do that because that would all be on right and on power producers. And there is, of course, the issue of the old Burrard thermal plant in Vancouver. About the same size as Site C. It was closed because the good people of the Fraser Valley objected to the smog that occurred when winter inversions would track the exhaust in the valley. Okay, fair enough. But if that plant were used 4 or 5 days a year, just as the peaking power plant, it would itself substantially lower the requirement for any kind of new generation for OD. But the fifth alternative is the obvious one, and that's conservation. We can talk a lot about how to do that, but I noticed that this was put forward by no less a person than the former CEO of BC Hydro, and it cost him his job. So, if we build it, suppose we build it for 8.8 billion that they confessed, as opposed to 7.9 that they told, there is no domestic market for this. It would take $1 billion worth of new transmission equipment to move it to Alberta, even assuming you persuade the Albertans to buy it. The Albertans can generate all the power they want from natural gas at around $55 a megawatt hour. If we have to sell them Peace River power, Site C power, we would be just walking in a loss of about $50 a megawatt hour. So above the whatever contracts we can get. If you use the other alternative, that is, maybe there's two alternatives. You can persuade some LNG operator to use it by granting high concessionary rates, which is what's happened at Woodfibre. But even then, that's not going to go anywhere because no big LNG plants anywhere in the world use grid electricity. There's one in that would log in a loss of $128 a year. With no payment on the precedent, you may recall the current financing proposal from the government of British Columbia is that this thing will be financed on a on an interest-only basis for 70 years with no payment on principal. That'd be a nice mortgage if you could get it. And that also assumes that they can roll over debt at these very large volumes at prices of over 3%. And this is delusional. So even under these wild assumptions, if you did all that, you'd pay $9 billion in interest over 70 years. You'd still owe the full 8.8. And that's what we as ratepayers and taxpayers have yet to face. The bottom line is the financing risk on this thing is crazy, and it's all yours. And that's where I should stop.
Gordon Campbell was in. We had a new relationship, and he was working towards that. where they want to go with First Nations. So the biggest fight and the biggest disappointment I have is with Justin Trudeau. That man, the most important relationship to me is First Nations. The most, you know, I'm going to live up to the Declaration of Indigenous Rights. We're going to implement every recommendation of the Truth and Reconciliation Report. And he walks away from it all. He tells us that consent doesn't mean veto. So no doesn't mean no. What does it mean? That we as a government have the authority to decide what's right for Canada. And I know my good friends and Swallow have met with the Attorney General, our good friend that we spent years with. And she sat there and looked him in the eye and said, it's for the good of Canada. She was talking about Kingdom Hearts. And this is the kind of people we have making decisions for us. That can't speak their hearts, that can't do what they have to do because it's their good of Canada. But is it really? Is sight see such a good thing? So the cost, having the cost on the destruction of a relationship, the destruction of a trust, especially when people made those promises to you, would be okay. I mean, we expected her to be like he was. Nobody expected anything different from that, right? but you know, there was a God up there, and he converted so many people. So many First Nations were proud to be marching down the street with him. And now the youth vote is Glenn. He's not going to do that over again. Didn't he promise us this? I think a lot of people are seeing things differently. And, you know, First Nations are going to continue to push free, prior, and common consent. Because that's what we need to have. But it doesn't seem like that's what we're getting. You know, one of the biggest costs I see is the burial sites, cultural sites, the heritage sites. And you know, when you sit down with the people with the government and they're trying to work out an accommodation or a compensation package, how much money do you ask for? The graves of your mother, grandmother, your great grandmother, the ancestors. How much do you put on a sacred site, sacred ground, where your ancestors have drawn strength forever? They were doing this to us when they were giving over the tree farm license in my territory, but just a territory. And I can't put a value on that. How can I get a compensation package when I can't even put a value on it? How much does it cost to give up your right to hunt? You know, the area we're talking about, there's so much development. Oil, gas, mines. Everything you can think of in that area. And now you've got another dam. The cumulative effects alone on the Treaty 8 people is massive. And I think, again, why do we have such a big file of the Constitution? But all the court cases are saying, we can't infringe on your rights if it's for the good of Canada. And so you infringe and you infringe and you infringe and there's nothing left. What then? In the Chilcote case, they're very clear. You've got to make sure you have enough resources for today and future generations. If everything's gone, if all the moose are green when you open them up, when the fish have too much mercury in them, what do you have left? And how much cost is there in that? You know, I don't think those numbers, I know those numbers, aren't going to cost $28 billion to build Site C. Because the cost of losing a sacred site, the cost of losing a right, is invaluable and irreplaceable. And I think that I'm just thinking of what they're doing up there. It's just so horrendous to all the people 2019 BC Hydro says we don't know what we're going to do, but we will take 45 megawatts of power every year until then. And this is for small projects, micro projects, and bigger projects. You know that the clean energy industry in British Columbia has invested the 8.6 million, the same as I've seen. They've invested $8.6 million, billion in this province by building projects. And that's a lot. They've also supported almost 16,000 direct full-time equivalent of construction employment and another almost 5,000 first-year's employment in the coming years. So basically, there is 800 full-time jobs around the province, Site C is going to have 25 jobs. Of course, 25% of BC Hydro's power comes from independent power sources, and 14% from independent power producers. There are about 125 First Nations that are involved in the clean energy industry, and this comes from revenue sharing to full ownership and everything in between. It brings jobs, it brings money, it brings pride in the community, it brings a diversification of the economy. In my First Nation, we built a 6.5 megawatt project. Will we pay off all the debt? We're going to be getting 1.5 times the money we get from the Indian Affairs every year. 1.5 times. And to us, that's huge. From a First Nation that's always been dependent on the federal government to being able to be revenue. I just want to demonstrate a little bit more. Here at Vancouver Island, there's 22 clean energy projects. And that's 1.6 billion. And in development, there's another 200 million. The Cape Scott Wind Farm brings in $800,000 in taxes in the year 2015. Kokish River brought $1 million in property tax. Significant revenue to the areas that we're in. Monongahela Station has revenue sharing from that Kokish River of $165,000 to $190,000 a year, $100,000 a year, depending on the revenue. Kukus is almost $250,000. Mahajan Mushwood. And so all of these communities are benefiting from clean energy. But the government made a conscious choice to move away from that. The Sioux First Nation of Beechey Bay, they moved over a wind farm out in Sioux, out in that area with Island Timberlands. Was it Timberlands? Never remember. And that'll be 300 megawatts. Billions of dollars of investment. There are three First Nations up here, you know, that want to build projects up to 15 megawatts. I go around the province. The loss of investment for First Nations in clean energy is huge. Because, you know, clean energy has environmental values that First Nations want. They don't want the site seas. They don't want the LNG or the oil and gas. They want something with high environmental standards. Clean energy producers could have built projects as we needed power. Not all this power coming online was like, see, every 3 or 4 years, get some more projects going. You can just keep building as you needed it. The risk, the financial risk, is with those people. It's not taxpayers, it's not the government. It's private industry that takes that on. It's not the risk of you. And not only that, there's amazing technology right out there. You know, there's just British Columbia is going to be left in the dust. Because there's not going to be any opportunity. Lots of power producers are leaving the province because there's no opportunity. And what a loss. So that's kind of my own pet peeve. So the BC government consciously made the decision to shut the door on clean energy. $8.6 billion in investments. We don't need you anymore. And it's a tough, bad lever for second. And fighting for First Nations for their opportunities because they need this. And if we don't need the power, they're not going to buy it. So it is a tough situation, but there's a viable alternative out there to sightseeing. And we lobby every single Liberal member before the decision was made on sightseeing. They all knew, they all understood, but they wanted to build sightseeing that badly. And I think, as well, one of the points that I want to make is that where's the credibility in a government that spends almost $9 billion, maybe go higher, and they don't have anybody to sell the power to? I think they're kind of laughing stock. But unfortunately, you know, that's kind of what they're doing. And, I was remembering a story that I never heard you tell about there was a dam called Limestone in Manitoba, and they started building it. And after 2 years, they realized, hey, we don't have a market for this. And they stopped building it after 2 years. They put it on hold for 7 years while they went out and they got a power contract to sell it to the states. Now that's leadership, and that's a good thing to do. That can still happen in BC. Yeah, maybe they've spent a couple billion, but at least they're not going to spend the whole $9 billion. A friend of mine wrote this book, and I'm not trying to promote your book. But oftentimes, there's a lot of people who say, don't believe their homes, and they don't care where the power comes from. They've never been to the Northeast. They don't know the beauty of the peace. And Chris does a nice travelogue. Him and his photographer paddled down in 4 days, and they documented the birds and the every kind of wildlife, and talk to the homeowners. And it's really neat insight if you ever want to read this book. It kind of goes in history. I don't agree with my clean power, but I think it's good. Because a lot of times people, they don't go for us. They don't go out commuting. They don't do those things. They just think, I don't have my power. But they don't know what we're giving up. The pristine wilderness, that's good. So anyway, it's a neat kind of book. And so just in conclusion, the $8.8 million that allegedly is going to go to Site C is only a portion of what the real cost should be when you take into consideration the loss of sacred cultural and heritage sites, loss of treaty rights, the loss of lands that are important to families. And there's so many costs under Site C that cannot even be valued. The destruction of treaty rights and the relationships that go with that is immense and will impact Canada and BC for a very long time. The courts continue to allow for infringement. We need new judges. We need a new justice system. And as Canada celebrates 150 years, and what have we really accomplished? The colonialism continues, and the government pushes their projects through because it's for the good, for money for them, for jobs. And I think that with a decision that was unwise, as well as I have sightseeing, just means a real death knell to relationships of afraid that it's going to get built anyway, they would be left in the cold. And then now you have First Nation against First Nation. It's unfortunate that we've reached that point. My wish and my dream and my desire, and has been ever since the discussion on Site C, was that it not go ahead. And I don't know how we're going to stop it, but I think people are going to continue to fight on Site C for as long as they can. I once had a dream of sitting on a dam, and they were going to blow it up, and I can't remember why. It was a fight for the water anyway, and I went and sat on there with people maybe shooting guns at me. I don't know how I could do that, but in my dream I did. And you know, just for me, it's important for us to fight for water. Water's our life. You know, I stand with those that are fighting pipelines or fracking. And I've always stood to create those that are closing Site C. I appreciate the opportunity to share my thoughts with you and look forward to hearing your voices out there as we all fight for the same cause. Play cool, play cool.
Well, that's a tough act to follow. I just want to say that my email has been hacked by Dr. Swain BCers. So much of what I'm going to talk about tonight. Dr. BCers stole my Fast Furious fiasco. Much to my chagrin. I've been working with the Treaty 8 First Nations for, oh God, about 12 years now. West Norley and Prophet, Cloud Lake and Doig initially on the Site C, judicial reviews, and now it's West Norley and Prophet River. But I want to be clear that, with the exception of McLeod Lake, which is down near Tilka Ridge, none of the other First Nations have signed on to any IBAs with BC Hydro. Although they're talking about IBAs and land compensation, you know, the First Nations were pretty clear when it came time for the decision from the government that they were vehemently opposed to Site C, that it was an infringement of their treaty rights. And, you know, for a variety of reasons, you know, First Nations decided to pursue litigation, but they don't. And the costs are enormous, and it's a burden that my clients have had to carry through the federal courts as well as the BC courts. We got a couple of decisions, a couple of very disappointing decisions, one on January 23rd from the Federal Court of Appeal, and one from the BC Court of Appeal last week, dismissing our judicial reviews. So, obviously my focus is on First Nations, but in terms of the way in which we approach these court cases, you know, we raised all of the arguments around economics, around alternatives, around the need for the project. We had, I think, a very solid report from the Joint Review Panel with a there's a few parts of it that we don't like, which seem to get quoted all the time, but I assume that Dr. Swain didn't write that part of the report. I think it was probably one of his colleagues about being the cheapest option and so on and so forth. But I think that Site C is it's a bit of a microcosm of the way that this government does business, and it is one of the most opaque governments, I think, in history. In this case, they eliminated all oversight, all independent oversight. They eliminated the BC Utilities Commission, the Agricultural Land Commission. They enacted the Clean Energy Act, which basically stacked the deck, making Site C a fait accompli. They had this curious 93% requirement of energy that needed to be produced within BC. So we think they reverse engineered the project to come out, you know, Site C being the winner. They have this. This program, this top secret program, I think I refer to it as the HAL 9000. I think in another talk that I did, it's called the System Optimizer. And so we think that they crunched a bunch of numbers in the System Optimizer and came up with Site C in the sweet spot was 7.9 billion. So the environmental assessment certificates are granted, they say, well, it's in the public interest, or, you know, in the federal context, all of these environmental effects, which the Royal Society of Academics found it had the most unmitigable impacts, adverse impacts in the history of Canadian environmental assessment, under the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act. And that's been in place, I think if you go back to what they call Herbico, I think since the late 80s or thereabouts. But the federal government said, yeah, it's justified in the circumstances. And of course, we had ministers Pollack and Thompson saying, yeah, it's in the public interest. Notwithstanding, we can't make out the need, we can't make out the cost. I can't remember at all. Basically, the Joint Review Panel rejected all of their court claims in terms of economics. They said, go to the BC Utilities Commission and figure these things out. Well, they lied. They lied about the cost. 2 months later, the final investment decision is made. They haven't put a shovel in the ground. Suddenly it's 8.8 billion. What's the real cost? We don't know. They said, well, KPMG looked at it. KPMG produced a 5-page letter saying, well, your methodology is sound, you know, your inputs, what you're putting in here is good, but nobody's ever looked at this project in terms of what the costs are. And as Dr. Swain said, it's you, the taxpayers, our kids, maybe our grandkids, that are going to be paying for this white elephant. And this is only one project. We got LNG. We've got the massive tunnel replacement. You want to do this bridge? Again, no oversight. You know, this is a government that's, you know, their policy approach is a field of dreams. If you build it, they will come. That's the theory. So we've gone to court a few times, and we haven't done very well. And, you know, I think that the decisions of the courts obviously has an effect on First Nations and my clients directly and the other First Nations, but it also does violence to the environmental assessment process. When you have a panel that says, look, you've got all these problems, and you know, the panel, you know, Dr. Swain didn't go through this, but, you know, the panel was under a time crunch. They didn't really have a lot of resources to do the work that they had to do. And hydro, they snow you thousands upon thousands upon thousands of pages of dribble that you've got to go through. They do this on the First Nations as well. And, you know, they did a great job. They come up with a report and they say, we don't agree with your methodology. You got it wrong. The way in which you're dealing with impacts on tree rights is completely false. Your cumulative effects methodology is a joke. They did a narrative. The baseline was 2012. So those effects have already happened. So in terms of cumulative effects, we're going to start in 2012 and work our way forward. And those aren't significant. So what did the government do with the report? Nothing. They didn't send it to the BCUC. They didn't go back for further environmental assessment and say, do a proper cumulative effects assessment. They didn't do any of those things. I got a list of the effects that can't be mitigated. Fish, plants, birds, First Nations exercise of rights, Dr. Sayers references. We all know dams kill fish. Dams poison fish. Methylmercury. The First Nations up here have been dealing with methylmercury since the W.E.C. Bennett Dam. 50 years. Massive infringement. They were never consulted. They've never even been offered a dime, BCI. We have the Peace Canyon Dam. The First Nations put in evidence. They said, look, we can't fish. We can't fish in any of these tributaries anymore. And now you're going to put a third dam in, take up 85% of the Peace River in BC, and you're going to infringe on our treaty right. We have a treaty right to fish. It was never addressed. And as Dr. Sears said, the Peace River block, has been and continues to be pounded by oil and gas, mining, roads, three hydro dams now, wind farms, roads. You know, the First Nation, the First Nations are still waiting for this cumulative effects assessment. BC has finally said, well, they're still working on terms of reference now for what they call RCEA, a regional strategic environmental assessment. One of the things that the panel recommended they do before they approve this project. So, you know, by the time this thing's done, you know, that ship may have sailed. Well, where's this oil and gas going to come from if we get LNG? Well, it's going to come from Northeast BC. It's not coming from Alberta. So there you go. There's even more cumulative effects that come from that. So I wanted to spend the rest of my time just talking about, just briefly, I think I'm mostly speaking to the converter, but talking a little bit about the treaty and what it means. It was signed in 1899, and it covers large parts of Alberta, Northeast BC, Saskatchewan as well, I think, as well as a little piece of the Northwest Territories. And it provides that First Nations may continue their, this is a language from the treaty, their usual vocations of hunting, fishing, and trapping, but the government may take up lands for forestry, mining, settlement, and so on. So in the treaty itself, there are these competing rights. And we did a case called West Moberly, and unfortunately the judge, he decided that case retired. So we didn't draw him this time. And he said, you know, they're competing rights, one doesn't trump the other. But yet BC acts as though they can take up lands to effectively extinguish the rights. And that's what's going to happen here. Notwithstanding that they're not actually legally competent to do that under the Constitution, but you know, you hear the phrase death by a thousand cuts. Well, I mean, this is a pretty big cut. It's not just, you know, some little well set somewhere. So when we went to court, we argued two things. We argued the consultation angle, which is, you know, pretty much all of these recent court cases have talked about in terms of the Crown's duty to consult with the First Nations, get their comments, and try and accommodate their interests. But the other aspect we said, and it's kind of been conflated by the courts as well as by the media, is we said, well, look, given the current state of the land base and the cumulative effects, you need to consider whether or not by approving this project you've crossed the line. You're going to breach the treaty. And DC, although you didn't negotiate the treaty, you, as part of the Crown, are indivisible. You are a party to that treaty, that contract, that solemn contract. You need to turn your mind to this. You need to think, do we need to pause here and see and figure this out? Do we have any obligation? And so the court says, well, that's way too complicated. They don't have jurisdiction to make that determination. It's way too difficult. I think the joint review panel figured it out pretty quickly. They're like, well, we think there might be an infringement here, you know? But the genesis for this is a case called Mikisew, and it's paragraph 48. It's the paragraph that I hate the most. And it suggests there can't be any infringement until the right is extinguished. And so the First Nation may sue for damages, and until that time they get consultation. And so what does that mean? Well, you know, the courts seem to have accepted this approach. They say you can't sue for infringement until it's all gone. And we can't decide it in this type of proceeding. So this is a judicial review. This is it's different from doing an action. We just finished a case for Treaty 8 on a very simple issue. You know, where's the line? Where's the western boundary of Treaty Number 8? Took 12 years, I think, from when we filed. No, 11. We finished in 2016. So these cases take a long time. Certainly an infringement case, you know, infringement on the treaty right to fish or infringement on a treaty right to hunt will probably take at least as long. And by that time, guess what? How the town's built. And so why you get our damages? So that's where the courts kicked it out. They said, well, look, we're not gonna make these determinations. Go bring an action, and then maybe you can go get an injunction. What's the likelihood you're gonna get an injunction when $1.9 billion or whatever the latest is has been invested in this dam? One of the requirements when you're asking for an injunction is to get what's called an undertaking for damages. Is any First Nation gonna put up $1.9 billion? It's just not gonna happen. So in Treaty 8, I think in the number of treaties, there's 11 across Canada. They have very similar language. You have this odd situation where a Treaty 8 member may be required to get a license. This is the case called Badger. They say, the government requiring you to get a license to hunt, well, that's an infringement of your rights. But you can deny them the means that exercise that right. So in this case, in the Peace River, and there's extensive evidence that was presented by the First Nations, and as Dr. Sager said, extensive archaeological evidence, you know, that they've been there since time immemorial, the First Nations. That's not infringement. We're going to flood, you know, 10,000 hectares, and who knows trying to think of terms of expropriation, what they call it. The effects extend far beyond that, on fish and wildlife. Well, that's not an intrusion. It seems really odd to me. And so that's a situation that, you know, if we're gonna go to the Supreme Court of Canada, if we have to seek relief, we have to seek the court's permission. That's a problem with the law that we need to fix, because if that's the way the government's going to proceed, and that's the way they proceeded, they from the outset, we saw BC Hydro's legal opinion, it's like there can't be infringement. Just consult. You know, offer them some beets and trinkets. Hopefully, that'll stop. I just want to talk about the federal government, our feckless federal government. And I'm talking about the Trudeau government in this case. I think they failed to uphold the honor of the crown. So the decision to approve the project was Harper's, the Harper government. So no surprise there. But when the Trudeau government came in, we had hope, given you know, their promises, and they had opportunities. They had ample opportunities. The First Nations. We met with the ministers. We went out in December to Ottawa and crashed the Liberals' Christmas party. And gave the ministers all kinds of briefing materials and the like. And met with Minister LeBlanc, who is the Minister of Fisheries. Met with the Minister of Canada and said, "Look, you got to take another look at this order of council." And they said, "No, we're just going to look forward." And they issued these permits. The fisheries permits, this was in the news back in the summer. Fisheries permits, navigable waters permits to allow the dam. And it's, you know, rather than supporting the First Nations treaty rights, you know, Canada repeated the same mistakes they made with WAC Bennett and Peace Canyon. They acquiesced, they just sat on the side and said, well, none of their problem. You know, it's crazy, you know, you think about what happened in the United States, you know, contrast the situation that's been going on in Washington State for the last 45 years. It's been the federal government that's been taking the state of Washington to court repeatedly. Now, with Trump, I don't think it's likely it's going to happen anytime soon, but to protect the tribes, right, to the fish. You know, going back to the 70s, it's U.S. versus state of Washington. You know, protecting the tribes' rights to fish. In this case, Canada just rolled over and said, okay, what Christine wants, Christine gets. So what now? I think reconciliation, as Dr. Sayers said, is a distant goal, right? That the courts have effectively given the Crown carte blanche. You know, when you read the judgments, they're on the internet. I mean, they say basically, as long as they provide a process, So if the First Nations, you know, well, look, you got to comment on the terms of reference. You got to comment, you know, on the Crown Consultation Report. You got to comment on all of these great things. So what's your complaint? Well, you didn't change the project at all. Like the height of the dam didn't go down this 10 meter. You know, the length of the dam, they say, oh, look at all these modifications we did. You didn't do anything. You didn't look at alternatives. You didn't really do anything, you know, particularly in this case, none of the conditions or the accommodations really address the substance of the First Nations complaint. And, you know, the BC Court of Appeal, you know, we were hopeful, like there we had the Enbridge decision, the Kala decision, which we said was on all fours, you know, joint review panel report. And the Court of Appeals spent one paragraph on it and said, oh, this is totally different. Said it's not. You know, why bother with the EA process? Why bother with consultation? If the government can just simply run roughshod over their environmental assessment process and over First Nations rights. You know, if the Crown doesn't have a positive obligation to ensure the treaty promises are fulfilled, they can just simply run roughshod over First Nations. And so, I think when you read the cases, I mean, essentially the underlying thing is First Nations must give way to the government regardless, you know, of the project. You know, the Crown doesn't have any burden to show they need the project. It's just, they say, well, it's in public interest. And the courts go, well, we're not going to go there. We're going to give these elected officials deference, assuming that they actually are acting in public interest as opposed to, you know, some legacy project to try to get reelected because they haven't actually produced any of the things they said they were going to do. So I think I'll end it here.
So I'd really like to hear your reactions. How well has the opposition understood this? Are they pushing it harder? Should they push it harder? Should we be spending time agitating with them rather than with the government? Which option doesn't work?
As I understand it, John Horgan has been not definitive, and if anybody knows better, you can let me know. I think he was waiting to see how far along the project got by the time of the election and how much money had been spent to date. So I think he was a bit ambivalent. I think he wanted to, but he was not coming out strongly. I believe the Greens are against Site C and will do everything they can to reverse what's happened up there. That's my feeling. I don't know if John knows any better.
I mean, I know that Adrian Dix is pretty well informed on this, particularly on the economic side of things and tracking what's coming out in the BC Utilities Commission. So, you know, even though the approval of the project didn't go through BCUC, you know, all the subsequent decisions sort of on the economic side have had to go through the Utilities Commission. So a lot of evidence has come out in terms of, you know, the government bearing a lot of this information. Federally, Charlie Angus of the federal NDP seems to be the one sort of leading the charge. And there was another, some liberal backbencher, I think, said he was going to ask some questions. When this whole issue was coming up around, you know, the issuance of the permits, the fisheries permits and the navigable waters permits.
Yeah, I believe that was Robert Ouellet. He's a First Nation MP. So, you know, I think the most critical election will be this May. And I think people are informed. I think it's just a matter of what they believe in and what they think.
But the Liberal government currently is sort of hitting the drum, which is saying, look, we spent all the money. You've got to consider those sunk costs in the decision report. Here, I don't know if you'd like to say anything about that particular problem. It's hard to explain to the public problem.
Yeah, it is hard to explain. Let's suppose that by election time they've spent $2 billion and there's seven left to go. Your rational question is always, all right, what does the extra seven get me? Not what's happened in the past. The answer is the extra seven gets you $9 billion worth of debt instead of two.
Because I think there's some strategies with deferring the dam as opposed to just canceling it. And so there's legal ways to get around those contracts, as I understand it.
And they need to see the contract.
Yeah, I mean, we did do an injunction application on the first set of permits, which was really the site preparation. And we did see the contracts. And basically, the contractors were taking on all the risk. Now, I doubt in terms of, you know, the main civil works contract, that they're quite as weighted in favor of BC Hydro, but certainly those contracts, you know, we were making the argument, we were saying, look, you know, because they're saying, oh, all these contractors are you know, going to be out of work. It's like, well, they went in knowingly, right? They knew when they signed this contract, there's no guarantee they're getting any work, when it's going to be, and, you know, if Hydro gets an injunction against it, well, too bad, you can't sue us.
The government, I think, had a very clear idea that it wanted to build this dam and would take the minimum necessary steps to clear the way for that to happen. To that effect, they gave the environmental assessment panel a very restrictive set of guidelines. They said, among other things, that we were not to opine on whether or not there are treaty rights infringements. We were just simply to list what the First Nations had to say. We were not allowed to count the Columbia River entitlement as part of BC's assured supply, thus making the supply-demand balance tilt rather dramatically. We had to accept every jot and tittle of what's in Mr. Campbell's Clean Energy Act of 2010, which is, in one sense, a rather high-minded, renewable-oriented kind of piece of legislation. But in the other is, let's say, financially irrational. John's comment about the system optimizer, I think, was kind of interesting because, you know, no matter what numbers you put into the optimizer, it came out site C. And some of those restrictions were embodied in the Clean Energy Act of 2010. There were restrictions on time in getting it done. We had a grand total of 8 months. We were allowed a month of public hearings. We thought of asking whether they meant a calendar month or 30 days, and then we thought, no, we're not going to ask. We'll just use 30. We didn't in the end because we allowed for some snow days and had a mild winter. But we had practical difficulties in getting expert help for the panel, even though this was promised in terms of reference. For example, to go to the economics again, we decided that we as a panel decided we wanted to have an expert on utility economics and who could guide us at least to the right questions and maybe some of the right conclusions on this. And they said, well, what do you need that for? You got BC Hydro. Well, no, we'd like someone who is independent. Well, all right, then you have to write down exactly everything you want to know from this person. You have to translate it into French. You have to put it up on Merck's. You have to advertise it nationally, and if you insist, internationally, but nationally. You have to choose the cheapest compliant bidder. Right? Well, that would have taken longer than 8 months, so it became a practical impossibility. We had quite a fight to get an independent counsel for the panel. British Columbia said, well, we have Buggins here from the Ministry of the Attorney General. You can use him. No. We then found a couple of very fine individuals, engaged one, and things went along fine. But that took probably a week of the chairman's time early on when we were trying to plow our way through 24,000 pages of environmental impact statement from BC Hydro. So it was a stressful time. And the idea that that one could attain perfection in the final report under those circumstances is generous of you, sir. One of the interesting things, I mean, Judith is talking about the possibilities for renewable power in BC. And you can imagine there are some limits on solar, but you know, still, whatever. But boy, are we a wonderful place for wind. And we have 700 miles north-south geography to get, and so the wind's going to be blowing somewhere. And on top of that, we have the most magnificent storage battery you ever saw, just those big reservoirs. In other words, you can use the wind while the wind blows and use the water while it doesn't. In that sense, integrating wind into the BC system is easier than it is in any other utility in North America. And we're not taking advantage of that.
Well, you know, at $9 billion, you're looking at 20 fast ferries fiascos. I'm not an economist.
That's 80 ferries.
That's like 80 ferries. But I made the reference to, you know, the field of dreams. And I think that, you know, that's superficially attractive, right? When government says, well, we're going to need that power someday. So why don't we build the dam now? You know, we did W.A.C. Bennett back in 67, and look at what a great legacy that provided for us. And, because it's funny, you know, I travel around, and sometimes I, you know, cabbies ask me questions, and they go, well, what are you doing? I'm like, oh, well, you know, I was just in court and challenging Site C Dam, and he's like, yeah, you're going to lose. We need that power. I'm like, well, you know what? We got a surplus, a huge surplus.
Yeah.
You know, people don't know this. People think, oh my goodness, well, we, you know, our rates are going up. They're going to go up 40% over the next 5 years. But we got this massive surplus. And, you know, I think I took economics one class in university, but that doesn't seem to make sense to me. You know, the laws of supply and demand dictating price. But perhaps Dr. Swain can explain that to me.
Anybody here ever tried to explain anything to a lawyer? You know, you ask an interesting question. Where are the folks on this stuff? And part of the problem, I think, is that we together, the 4.5 million of us in BC, are not very good at arithmetic. We're not interested in it. We don't pay attention to it. We go to sleep. These are big numbers. Who can tell a billion from a million and la, la, la. Let me very quickly give you another story that is related to this. Every utility in Canada operates under Canadian generally accepted accounting principles, Canadian GAAP. The government of British Columbia has a law in its Financial Administration Act that says that all entities of the government of British Columbia, including departments and commissions, crown corporations and so on, will keep their books according to Canadian GAAP, except, if inconvenient, when a few years ago, when there was a change in the basic accounting standard, the International Financial Standard came out, you know. Boy, that is an eye glazer for you. It meant that companies had to account for things like pension liabilities as they occurred. So if you've got your employee's pension sitting over here and the market goes down, you're supposed to account for that as an obligation of the company. It goes onto your costs, it lowers your profits, and so on, right? This was inconvenient for BC Hydro and for its owner, because in the 2008 year, the value of their pension fund dropped by $200 million, and this would have to be recorded as a loss, and it would reduce the rather notional profit that Hydro made, and therefore the dividend that Victoria could claim. The dividend is important to a minister of finance who wants to claim that he's financially prudent. All right, so what do you do in such a circumstance? Well, the easy thing is change the accounting standard. So suddenly there was a midnight order in council that said that BC Hydro, alone among all other, will do its accounting according to an American standard called FASB 980. which is fairly generous on the issue of deferral accounts. A deferral account is set up by a corporation when it's got, let's say, very lumpy capital expenditures and a steady stream of income, and it doesn't want, as in the case of a utility, to face its customers with a big increase one year and a decrease the next year and so on and so forth. People seem to be happier when their rates are steady. So deferral accounts are normal in the utility business. They usually never amount to more than 6 or 7% of the equity of the company, which in our case would be a couple hundred million dollars. BC Hydro has now run up deferral accounts over $5 billion. This is, let me give you an example of a deferral account. They have income, which they can accurately, pretty accurately forecast because the rates have been approved by the Utilities Commission for the next couple of years, right? So that income can be, if you want, it can be accounted for now. Prudently, you would account for it only when you get it. In the out years, let's say from 2019 onward, Hydro says it needs a 14% increase in rates or whatever the number is, and that's the number. And we know that the government isn't going to stand for it. But they nonetheless put that sum in a deferral account, say that it's money that's owed to them by us or our kids. It's therefore income in the present year. It counts as a as part of the notional profit of BC Hydro, on which or from which water rentals and dividends are paid. Now, how'd they get there? The American standard allows these deferral accounts to be set up only if the amounts are approved by an independent third-party regulator. Aha. So guess what? A little later, there's another midnight order in council that says that BC Hydro will now operate according to the proscribed standard, which is FASB 980, with no mention of a regulator. They can make it up. They don't have to have a regulator look at it. Now, all that's assuming that you think that BCUC is in fact an independent regulator at this point, subject as it is to orders, directions, and whatnot, whenever convenient.
Yeah, I just want to add to that, that I think a lot of people could care less about Site C,
yeah.
Just like they could care less about LNG. You know, the people are very, they sit at home and they don't care, they turn on their power as long as it's there, as long as it's adequate, then a lot of these issues, they're not in their backyard. And until they're in their backyard, they're not going to pay attention. You know, they had those millions and millions of people go out and march over Trump. Why can't we do that with Site C? Why can't we do that with Kinder Morgan? Like, where are people caring? And I think that's, you know, what our big job is to make people care. Look, we're destroying a portion of British Columbia that is never going to come back in the way it should. You're destroying, you know, the lives of a lot of First Nations people. And I find that, you know, that that's a real problem. You know, you can fight for whatever you need, but unless you have enough support, then it's going to be really difficult to do so. So I think that's the big challenge, is making people aware. These deferral accounts, the Auditor General is doing a review of them because, you know, at what point does BC Hydro become totally unable to operate because of the deferral accounts? You know, and yet, you know, we're trusting them with $9 billion to build this dam. You know, and a lot of the predictions means that, you know, by, I can't remember what year, 2 years from now, that the power is going to go up by a 50% increase to start paying for Site C. And that's a huge jump. And that's not what the government's telling you right now. But at some point, they're going to have to pay for all of that debt. And yet, BC government still puts their hands and says, you got to give us our money. Even though they know they've told them to go into all this debt. This year, they demanded that BC Hydro pay them that money. So there's a lot of things that are going on out there that, you know, people, unless they're keeping their eyes to the news or, you know, this is an issue that's important to them, they don't see it. And, you know, that's where we need the education.
I know that Blueberry River First Nation, also Treaty 8 First Nation, they're taking a different tack on Site C. They've They've launched an action, they've said the cumulative effects are too much. Essentially, you have extinguished, or you're getting very close to extinguishing our treaty right, same treaty right as my clients. They brought one injunction, they lost, and they were in court again in November trying to seek a second injunction, and the judge reserved on that. On the UN declaration, I mean, you know, it's interesting the way in which the government of Canada has backtracked on that. I think, you know, like all politicians, they make these broad promises without understanding what the implication is of that. And so I think rather than casting aspersions on it, I think they were just naive in terms of what it actually means, because consent does mean consent. And, you know, removing the permanent objector status that Canada had on that was one step. But in order to get it into Canadian law, we need legislation, yep. Domestic legislation. So until we get that, then it's aspirational, you know, is the way that the federal government says it is. I mean, I think that even the cases like Delgamuukw, for instance, talks of consent, and Haida Nation sort of backtracks from that. He said, well, you know, the consent spoken in Delgamuukw is not in all cases, and only in the case of established rights. Mm-hmm. Well, we got established rights here.
Okay. Yeah. Can I also add on to that? The declaration is just a declaration. The Covenant on Civil Political Rights is a convention that states actually have to sign on to and is legally binding. The declaration is meant to, it's just like the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and it is kind of a moral or ethical type of document. The UN destroyed or took apart the Working Group on Indigenous People that drafted the declaration. And so normally what happened after you do a declaration, you would start working on a convention. We need a convention on the rights of Indigenous people. But the body that was going to do it is now gone. But that was done, I think it was done very deliberately. But this spring, I'm not quite sure what month it is, but the Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination is meeting. And Canada is filing their reports on how wonderful they're treating their Indigenous people. And I know there's a lot of First Nations people that are from Canada that will be over there presenting material to this committee, showing them otherwise. And there have been some emergency applications filed. And there should have been one on Site C, I think, to do that. I think the people from NALCORP and, you know, the Labrador incident were going to try and do that. So there are other mechanisms internationally. But it does take time and effort, and you have to know the system over there as well.
This afternoon, in preparation for this evening, some person not far from me arranged for me to go on CFACTS. And so I spent 15 minutes talking to the lady in the station and some people who are calling in. Now, it was interesting. The people who were calling in or sending in emails were all over the province. They weren't just local. And they were all saying things like, should have gone to BCUC, economics are lousy, environmental effects are the greatest we've ever seen, la la la. In other words, I was having a hard time objecting to anything that people were saying. There's some indication that people all over the province are beginning to, that the story is beginning to sink in. But it's a slow process.
I also think we need good laws. Remember Harper, who gutted with two omnibus bills, 38-45, they stripped the Canadian environment, they just threw out the whole Canadian environmental assessment and put in place CIA 2012. And they did the same thing to NEB and the Fisheries Act, and they gutted it. And yet Trudeau, I mean, he continues to approve projects based on these horrible laws that he promised to change. And it's just been the last little while that he's been sending around these groups to ask all of us, what do we want to see in the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act? What do we want to see? I know they've been doing the ones on the NEB. But it takes a lot of time, and how much they're going to take into consideration and actually form good laws. When are they going to put BCUC oversight back into BC law? There's just so much that we, you know, if we start with good laws, then that helps as well. So not the only answer, but it's part of the answer.
You know, I think it is. I think it is a combination of you know, the courts. The courts going back, you know, to, you know, first principles around reconciliation, honor the crown, those concepts, right? You know, they throw those words around, but they never really seem to apply them. And when Haida Nation came out, you know, the concept of consultation and accommodation that they had has become so watered down since 2004. You know, as a lawyer practicing in administrative law, it's not about the honor of the crown. It's just become what we call procedural fairness, you know, right to be heard. And that was never the intent. The intent of Haida, and they say this in Beckman, they say, what we're trying to do is we're trying to head off these infringement cases. You know, the crown needs to inform itself ahead of time. It's like, ask itself, well, if we approve this project, and Haida says this in paragraph 47, which is interesting, when the BC Court of Appeal quoted, they took out the word infringement. In paragraph 47, they say, you know, after deep consultation, the Crown's duty is to take steps to avoid irreparable harm, and that's what we've been talking about, which means you can't compensate in damages, and the potential for infringement. Well, you know, when the Crown is sitting there saying, well, there can never possibly be an infringement, well, then that's a different conversation altogether. So, you know, I haven't given up on the legal system yet. When I do, you know, maybe I'll go be a prof somewhere. But, you know, politically, certainly, I think we need to hold, you know, the Trudeau government to their promises. This Liberal government, I think, provincially, you know, they're linos. They're Liberals in name only, right? I call them the Republican Party of BC because they're very much like that. So I don't have a lot of faith in them. But sooner or later, they're going to have to, you know, get that message. You know, Chilcotin came out how long ago?
2014.
Almost 3 years.
Well,
3 years in jail.
Things haven't actually gotten better in First Nations country. I mean, I don't just work with Treaty 8, I work all across the province. They've actually gotten significantly worse. I went to a meeting with the Minister of Aboriginal Relations a few weeks ago, John Rusta, the poor man. Like, you can just tell he's just beaten down so bad. Like, he says, I can't remember things being as bad as they are now. So, UNDRIP, yeah. I mean, we really got to push Trudeau on his promises on UNDRIP and overturning those omnibus bills. But I think it's a combination of things, and hopefully there are a couple cases that are outstanding in Supreme Court of Canada, from back east and one from the north. Chippewas of the Thames, which involves an NEB decision, and another one involving Clyde River, which I hope will get back to that robust process where it's more like a collective bargaining, a labor law kind of standard that the Crown was expected to do in Haida, where, you know, it's equal parties sitting down and negotiating, not the Crown saying, this is what we're going to do, what do you think, and then we'll try and mitigate and we'll offer you a little bit of cash over here, which is what happened here.
So what do you want? I'd like to ask Dr. Sayers and Mr. Galis, honestly, what do you think will be required to change the governments in this country's response to First Nations to respect Aboriginal title, rights, and interests, short of another Oka crisis, a Gustis and Lake crisis, or a Standing Rock crisis? What will it take?
I really wish I knew. You know, we've been doing a multi-pronged approach. We've done the courts, we've done the land, we've done the international, and we'll continue to do that. But until we actually get some honest governments, people in there, you know, I don't know what's going to change that. I've been reflecting a lot about, you know, how I can make an impact about the 150 years, you know, and is there anything that we can do that's positive? And that's, it's really hard. You know, and to the other question, you know, like you go to court and you lose, you got to appeal and you got to appeal, and it's so expensive, you know, and we've been really, you know, appreciate some of the fund, the crowdfunding sites and the help of Council Canadians and other groups that have helped to do it. But, you know, I mean, there's a lot of people that are looking to First Nations to help stop these projects. And so they're willing to come and put money up. But if the, you know, if the courts continue to just say, okay, we can mitigate, and in some cases abrogate, and not look back, I don't know where we are. I mean, it's very difficult. You know, I had always hoped that we'd be able to settle in treaty and then my kids could be implementing it, but they're fighting and they're on the protest lines as much as I am. You know, and what kind of a future is that? And so I think, you know, we're just going to keep trying, and the same kind of things are going to happen. You know, and I think Kinder Morgan is going to be one of those flashpoints, and that's going to start soon, too.
When BC Hydro first proposed Site C in about 1981, they went to the Utilities Commission for approval. And in a decision in 1983, the Utilities Commission said, you haven't done your homework. Let's see your demand numbers, and by the way, we think you should go explore the geothermal potential of British Columbia, 34 years ago, and the homework hasn't been done.
I think there's a lot of information out there, and a lot of communities are trying to become independent of the grid, you know, whether it's just solar or a wind turbine, geothermal, even putting something in like your ground source heat pump, zero emission homes. Like there's just so many things that we can do to reduce our use of power. And, you know, and BC Hydro calls it their,
they call that demand side.
Energy smart or whatever they call it. You know, just how to reduce power in our homes. And we can do that. And I think that's important. It's important for us to do. You know, some of the bills that people are paying in the north for heat are huge, and we can reverse those kinds of things with all of those small things that as individuals we can do. But that information is easy to find. You just have to find the right organization or the right person to do that.
And just on the geothermal point, post panel, joint review panel, CanGEA actually did produce a report around geothermal. I can't remember in terms of the specifics in terms of what's in it, but it's probably on the web somewhere. Canadian geothermal.
Yeah, I think that's the main issue is, you know, they've made these promises and how do we hold them to it? And as much as you bring it up in the media, I mean, we've tried to slam Trudeau for everything he's not done. And does that help? Because now they're in power and now they're going to do whatever they want. So you're right. I mean, you have to try and put your faith in some individual or a party that may not live up to it because they think it's more important to be. I mean, look at Rachel Notley, you know, and she's, you know, close to the oil and gas community now. What happened to her? You know, so you really have to know these people, but it's a hard system and it's hard to go out and keep voting. And I think that's why a lot of people don't vote. Is that there are people just made these promises just to get elected and then they turn around and do something different.
At any rate, I would like you to join me in thanking these wonderful speakers for the discussion.